the other way. It was one other thing that I didn't like.
There was a lock on the back door. It was an illegal lock. So you have to have a key to open it. It's a fire hazard.
It was a couple of things. They about tell you, the home inspectors did a great job. They were all okay.
Like to call the regular monthly board meeting of the Bonita Springs Fire Control and Rescue District, Monday, February 13th, 2017, to order. We're going to have an invocation by Chaplain Chetwood, followed by the pledge. Please rise.
This evening, we want to remember the firemen that have lost their lives in duty this past month across the U.S. And just an additional note, Commissioner Lohan has a surgery this Thursday for some cancerous lymph nodes, and we want to remember him also in prayer. So let's have a moment of silence, and then I will pray. Dear God, we thank you for the service of those across this nation as firemen and first responders. And Lord, those that have lost their lives this past month, we pray that you'll be with their families, that you'll watch over them, that you'll give them strength and let them feel your comfort at a time of loss. And Lord, we pray that you'll be with Commissioner Lohan as he has this surgery, that you will bless the doctors and the nurses as they treat him. And Lord, we just ask you for healing and strength. Lord, we pray for our nation. We thank you for the blessings we have, and we want to seek you always in all things. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Any public comment on agenda items this evening? Seeing none, I need a motion for the approval of the January 9th, 2017 regular board meeting minutes, please.
So move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. One motion for the January 2017 and current expenditures and ACH payments, the acknowledgement of financial report, and the acknowledgement of wire transfers and transfers between accounts.
So move.
Second it.
All in favor?
Discussion.
Bear with me. I'm new in this position, so I'm just trying to remember exactly what these things are. On page one of the monthly transfers, we have two separate deductions for union dues, slightly different amount, $3,272 on January 5th and $3,166 on January 19th. I just wonder why a difference. Did we hire some new member at that time?
The first one is the total amount that comes out. The second one has the admin fee that the union pays the district to deduct the dues. It's from two different payrolls.
Say that again.
The first one is without the admin fee taken out. The second deduction, the $3,166.60, is with the admin fee deduction taken out.
They appear to be two transfers of funds. Sounds like you're saying one. One we collected the dues, and one we took an admin fee out, and then we had
two payrolls in January. January 5th is without the admin fee taken out. The January 19th one is with the admin fee taken out. We only take out the fee once a month.
Okay. Thank you, Lisa. Okay. On the same page, under the impact fee account loan transfers, there is no entry for Station 4 payment, which is the, is there a reason? Do we pay it on other than monthly or?
Oh, we pay monthly.
In January, we didn't collect enough impact fees to pay for the loan for this station. So there was no transfer of payment.
Okay. On the second page, which is the budget account, under item 335012300, we have a state supplemental compensation of $42,000. That is income. I want to know where that comes from or what that money is.
For all the state-certified firefighters, if they have their associate's degree or their bachelor's degree, the state reimburses us the $50 or the $110 that we pay the employees.
Okay. Lisa, would you speak into that machine so I can hear it too? Thank you. On the same page, under 362-01-001, we have facilities rental of $121,000.
From the county.
Could you tell me what that money is for?
That's what we charge Lee County EMS for their employees staying at our stations.
Thank you very much. And on same page, 369-01-004, we have an enhancement entry, $17,000, which is the budget amount.
That's for the radio enhancement. We haven't collected any this year, but that's so some of these larger buildings and the fire marshal could explain more about that. It's to help offset the cost of radio coverage in their building.
Basically, that money goes towards, Commissioner, that money is used towards when we inspect the building, they have an opportunity to either put a radio system in their building or pay us an enhancement fund in which we will outfit our trucks to provide a radio repeater and keep our communication systems upgraded for in-building coverage.
Okay, Chief, thank you. Okay, on page 3, same account. We have a fund or an entry called Other Assets Vehicle Prepayment, $898,000.
Last year we did a prepayment for the new ladder truck. So we have not taken possession of that ladder truck. When we take possession of it this year, it'll come out of the assets vehicle prepayment account and go and be expensed out.
Oh, okay. The ladder truck is on order? Is
yes.
It's being built?
For the new station.
And when is it due in?
That won't be done probably until, I would say, July, from my recollection. But we still have to outfit it and get it prepared for in service.
Thank you. Page 4, one additional item. 522-01-150. On the personal services, we have an entry called Special Pay Incentives, $56,000. That's beyond salary, holiday, longevity. What is that?
The $756,000.
Or is there maybe I overwrote it with my pen? Is it $756,000?
Yes. That's for the incentives with the firefighters, paramedic, pump operator, CPR.
Okay. That is fine. Lisa, I think that was all that I had. And I thank you very much.
You're welcome.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Need a motion to approve the disposal report that's in your packet.
Also move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Next, we have our Phoenix Awards presentations. Chief?
Yes, sir. I'm going to turn it over to Deputy Chief Rich Scott.
Good afternoon, everyone. So we are here to celebrate the life of a restoration of life of someone in our building tonight. And before we get into the details of the call, I'd like to show a short video that's very applicable to what we're here to discuss tonight.
Promise I'll be up here shortly. each year over 600,000 people have cardiac arrest in the United States. Today, only 7% survive.
I collapsed at a sudden cardiac arrest, and I was resuscitated at the age of 21.
49 the day after Thanksgiving.
I was 45 years old.
At my desk in my office.
At a restaurant celebrating my 48th birthday.
I collapsed. No pain, no reason, no warning.
Went in to get a cup of coffee. Boom. Dead on the floor.
It can happen to anyone, anytime, any place. And I know because it happened to me.
Sudden cardiac arrest, it's life-changing, not only for the victim that survives, but also for the family that loves that person.
I've been given a gift of my husband. He lived to walk his daughters down the aisle.
After my cardiac arrest, I never thought I would be around to see the birth of my grandson. And then they're alive.
Mostly, psychologically, it affects your family and your friends.
If your friend is down, don't you want to be able to act and help bring them back to their son, their daughter, their husband? Back to you.
We all need to learn CPR because CPR saves. We all need to learn how to use AEDs because they're effective tools in saving lives. It is as simple as that.
It is. We are all born with CPR tools right here in our own hands.
For all of the first responders, for all those learning CPR, for all of the doctors, electrophysiologists, and everyone in the industry, all I can say is thank you. And I can say thank you for my mother, I can say thank you for my father, I can say thank you for my fiance, and I can say thank you for me, from the bottom of my still beating heart, which is only made possible by you and your work.
Okay, so we have one of those cases. I think you all understand why I showed that short video. Pretty powerful. And we are on a campaign throughout this industry of ours, through the country, through the state, and specifically here in Bonita Springs, to make sure that every person that we come across knows how to do CPR, specifically chest compressions, and how to work an AED. And that brings me to the reason we're here tonight. Is to talk about an event that happened back on December 16th over at Worthington Country Club. And we had this exact situation. We had an individual that collapsed, and a bystander, Mr. Cox, that's sitting in our audience tonight, initiated CPR, and they had an AED on premise. He got the hold of the AED, and he did early defibrillation, and of course we have our survivor in the building as well. So I can't stress enough, and we do this every chance we get, so forgive me if you've heard this before, how important it is. There's several factors that contribute to this. As you noticed up there, they talked about 7% of people survive. We have been at this, not just me, but this industry for a long time, and in this presentation was given by a cardiac physician, 40 years, and we, unfortunately, haven't got a whole lot better at this. We've changed medications, we've changed equipment. So the refocus and the thing that seems to be making the most difference in survivability is what you did. It's the early defibrillation. I mean, and the early CPR. That's what makes a difference. So I'm gonna go into a few details of the call and go through, and then we're gonna invite some of the people that attended to Mr. Malcolm to come up in the front of the room and give them some recognition, well-deserved recognition. So the Phoenix Award is a representation of the mythical bird, if you all have heard of that before, that rises from the ashes. So it is given to someone that is clinically deceased, and they are brought back, or life is restored. So it is the highest honor we do here, as I mentioned, and it is really the reason we are all here. This is a perfect example of why all of us are here. Whether we're employed here, commissioners, people in the audience, this is what it's all about. So we try to make as big a deal as we can about it, because it's really, really a big deal. And we get used to doing it, but when we have a survivor, we make sure that we let that be known. So on December 16th, like I mentioned, at Worthington, person went down, Mr. Cox intervened. So that part of the three pieces was already there. And then the next part you have to have is a well-responding first responder team, fire and EMS, which we have here with us tonight. So they arrived next on scene and continued to attend to Mr. Malcolm, and they continued the CPR. They did additional defibrillations. They gave several medications that were dependent on the cardiac rhythm that he was in. They took care of his airway. And once they got a set of vitals back, and what we call ROSC, return of spontaneous circulation, then they transported him to the hospital. The third part of this that has to be in place is the hospital. One doesn't work without the other. When you have a lack of oxygen to your brain, again, I'm going back to this, but I like to mention it over and over, without early intervention, although we got there in 4 minutes, by the time it happened, which was unwitnessed, and we arrived, it was unlikely that, unfortunately, Mr. Malcolm would have survived without you, Mr. Cox. So a couple details. Call came in, just to outline, because we talk about response times. We were there in 3 minutes and 5 seconds from the time our crews got the call. So Worthington is pretty close to Station 4. So that was also in their favor. So I'd like to introduce each person to come up. And Chief, if you have the certificates, we can recognize them. And then at the end, if you wait, we'll give a big round of applause. So the first one I'd like to get up here is Mr. Andrew Cox, which is the one that initiated the care to Mr. Malcolm. And then our Engine 24 arrived on scene, and the crew that was on Engine 24 that day was Lieutenant Mike Mendez, Lieutenant Paramedic Mike Mendez. Firefighter Paramedic Terry Bonnell. Firefighter Juve Calero. Excuse me, Firefighter Paramedic Juve Calero. And Firefighter Paramedic Ernie Williams. Now we also had the ambulance that came, and from Lee County EMS, it was all part of the same process, and they actually transported and continued to treat Mr. Malcolm all the way to the hospital. And on that crew was paramedic Patricia Petito, and EMT Michael Staten, who's not here this evening. And then the man of the hour, we don't want to forget him, which was our survivor, and he's in the audience, is Mr. William Malcolm. If you would come up with that.
Worthington membership for their training and helping give you the tools to help assist in these types of incidents. But a great community, and we're glad that they've been there to help you, sir, and you also. So thank you very much.
Sir,
did also want to mention, Mr. Malcolm is also a CERC member here in Bonita Springs as well.
Thank you.
And a former volunteer fire chief. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Mr. Chairman, may I say a word?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Andy, I just want to say, Andy Cox, you are my friend and my neighbor, and it's a pleasure to be with you before this prestigious group. It's rare outside the world of the first responder to ever have the opportunity to say thank you to someone who saved someone's life. Not unusual here in the fire department. We do it occasionally and thankfully frequently, but I thank you. It's a pleasure to be your friend, and I want you to keep Bill Malcolm around. He's one of the few golfers that I can beat over there. Thank you, Andy.
Thank you all. Next item is a 15-year service pin.
Yes, I just wanted to recognize Jackie, fire inspector who's been here for 15 years. She does an outstanding job. She is not here. But I did want to recognize her as well. Item C, I would like to talk about the Coast Guard Auxiliary. I think today we have Vice Flotilla Commander, Mr. Richard Booth, and also Flotilla Staff Officer Frank Robb.
Thank you for having us here today. It's a pleasure to share this meeting with you. We serve the Coast Guard in a variety of ways. One of those is with our communication systems. We support Station Fort Myers Beach. We support Sector St. Pete with these communications with System 21, which is command, control, directional location communication system. We also support their patrol efforts as well as our own patrol efforts. We have mobile communication facilities in time of need and disaster. Recently, one of our antennas went down at our flotilla building. It's mounted on the top of about a 50-foot concrete pole. I requested my flotilla staff officer, Frank Rabb, to go up that pole, and he quickly said no, he wasn't going up. So we started looking for opportunities to help us out. Frank got in touch with the department here, and fortunately, a ladder truck came out with four individuals that helped us repair that antenna. We're back up in service, and we're very appreciative. So with that, if they're here in the audience, firefighter EMT Jason Burgess, firefighter paramedic Fred O'Donnell, firefighter EMT Kerry Coburn, okay, and paramedic Lieutenant Cesar Sanchez. Thank you again for helping us take care of that issue. It probably would still not be resolved were it not for you. So for outstanding cooperation and assistance in furthering the purposes and principles of Flotilla 96 and the U.S. Coast Guard Auxiliary, we really appreciate your help. Thank you very much. Two of our cups. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We can take a couple of minute recess if anybody would like to leave before the meeting is over. If you're just here for the awards part, if you're obviously you're all welcome to stay, but we won't put you through it if you would rather be at happy hour.
Andy. I tried to get the chief to give you a $500 check. You're a good man.
Okay, we can call the meeting back to order, I believe. Okay. Next item, Commissioner's business. Commissioner Murphy?
No business today.
Commissioner Casilla?
I just have a running question with Station 7. Any news on the lift or anything that we should know going on?
Deputy Chief Scott may have an update.
I don't have the best news, but I don't have real bad news. We're just waiting for the 60 days. It's supposed to be at the end of this month.
And that's so on the dock?
The dock.
Yeah.
For the permitting. I checked the other day, and it should be, I think it went in the end of December, so we're looking at the end of February. We're
You're talking about the Army Corps of Engineers?
Yes.
Okay. The pyramids got built quicker than this, but.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Commissioner Fitzgerald?
I have one point. I'm not too sure it's commissioner business or old business, but if you look at the minutes of the January 9th meeting, there is a reference there to Mr. Ron Pure making a complaint to the board. He made that complaint further to me personally, and I responded to it. So I want you to know what I did. Mr. Pure brought up 4 points that concerned him about the last election, the 2014 election, the one I lost, by the way. He was concerned, he brought to our attention there were some fines against the firefighters PACT group. And I told him that the activity of firefighters off duty is their business, not our business, hey, no concern.
I gotta ask you one question. Yeah. What year are you talking about?
Was it 2014?
No, it was an election in 8, 12, and 16.
Correction, there was 14.
I was elected in 14. Sure you were. Anyway, there was one in 14.
Was there
for
one?
Sure, Mr. Murphy.
Okay, I apologize. Okay.
Okay. So his concern had no value.
Midterm election.
The question of political activities of our members is not a concern of the Board of Commissioners. And the imposition of fines is not a concern. You fine the firefighter or the PACT off-duty, it is not, that decision is an election decision, not renewable by the Board of Fire Commissioners and not our concern. And these are the things I told him. There was one member of the fire department that served in two positions, a treasurer for one of the campaign members and as the chairman of the PACT group. Again, that's off-duty activities, not our concern. I say not our concern. Mr. Pure believes they are our concern, but I'm going to leave this letter for the commissioners when I finish. The only issue that I do have a concern with is that in 2013, the union dues of the firefighters were increased from $12 to $24 a pay. I checked the state statute. Increases of that nature require Board of Fire Commissioner approval. I have no recollection of voting on an approval. I have no recollection if they substantiated a reason for the increase.
You're saying that the commissioners have to approve a union dues increase? I don't think that's correct.
It is correct. I have it here if you want to read it, by the way. It is beside being correct. It is an absolute. I'll find it for you. I would ask you to take my word for it.
Okay. I've never seen that statute.
So let me ask you, sir.
Yeah.
Your question, you're saying that the commission has to approve a union dues increase?
The state law says any deductions, union dues, any deductions from the payroll of a member requires the approval of the supervisory or the board of, whatever board it is.
Yes,
that's true.
And it does say commissioners, by the way.
That's true.
So,
but that doesn't, it doesn't reflect on what's taken out. We have to approve, like, when there's a court order for, like, some firefighters have child support taken out of their check. Some people have optional health insurance and life insurance policies that are taken out of the check. And then Lisa, as an administrator, collects that money and then distributes it. But I don't think that we have any say in, we have no jurisdiction over the union in any way, shape, or form. And I don't believe we have to give the payroll, the administration department, the authority to deduct, but we don't have any say over what the deduction is for and if they raise their dues.
We have ultimate authority on anything they do when it's related to payroll dues deductions. I'll read you Florida statute 112.171. The counties, municipalities, and special districts of the state and the departments, agencies, bureaus, commissions, and offices thereof are authorized and permitted in their sole discretion to make deductions from the salary or wage of any employee or employees in such amount as shall be authorized and requested by such employee and for such purpose as shall be authorized and requested by such employee and shall pay sums so deducted as directed by such employee and employees. Is the intent and purpose of this section to vest in the public offices, agencies, and commissions herein enumerated the sole power and discretion to approve or disapprove requested deductions and the approval of and making of approved deductions shall not require the approval or making of other required deductions?
That's a fact, and we've done that. We voted to approve having the payroll deductions for the union dues, and that was done quite a number. The last one I saw was 2012, but nowhere in that statute do we have authority to determine how much their dues are, how much can be the employee can ask to be taken out of their check. We don't have that authority.
I didn't say we did.
If I may, sir.
I say.
Yes, I if I may, sir.
Yes, sir.
For one, I may be able to explain this. Union dues deduction has been part of negotiations for the last, since we've been a union, 25 years. Every time, it's actually in Article 3, in which the union shall be allowed to have dues deducted. So that has been a negotiated item, which has never, up until this point, been an issue. However, it's been signed in each three-year contract.
It's also an industry standard, at least locally.
Yes, but in any event, these years past, the board has approved union dues deductions with each approval of the contract.
In 2013, we, without the contract, a contract is in existence or will be in existence, we increased the dues deductions on the members by $12, doubled. That is, Only would take money out of their payroll if they asked you.
Yes, sir, and they
did. They doubled it.
And that's what the statute says. The employee can request. The employee.
And we have the sole discretion to approve or disapprove.
To approve only the deduction.
The reason I bring it up, Chief, there's a lot of reasons, but one critical reason is this money went to a PACT group, a political action group, that's function was to affect the outcome of this election for members of this board. If they asked you and me and this board for permission to bring that money to the PACT, I would think we would disapprove it. Now, I'm not saying they did that. My concern is, what did they ask, if anything? Did it ever get to the commissioners? I think you and I mentioned, talked about this a little bit, and I thought you said something, you remembered how it came about.
Yes, sir, I do.
Yeah, I know.
I actually have a letter here that I can distribute if you would like, from the request from a union official.
Okay.
That states that they did want to increase the dues, and that is what was sent to us. It wasn't a matter of, so that was basically sent to us, and it was simply a dues increase. Whether or not, I don't know, I would have to get our attorney to say if the board, for example, if they want to have a, let's just say a holiday party, and the board doesn't like that they're having a holiday party, will they not approve the dues if they know that that party's taking place, or whatever the case may be, whether it goes to a PACT or a charity event or anything, will that be, I would have to have our attorney to discuss whether or not that would be something the board would vote on.
We're not talking about parties, and by the way, when I read it, and you have ultimate authority, and they want to have a party, and you don't like it, you can deny it. That's what ultimate authority means.
I'm just going to add one more thing about
now,
this.
Now, I'm not interested in that. I have no fight in this, by the way. It was just brought to me. My concern is what was done. Now, you produced this letter for me. It's perfect. The union came to you, asked for union dues increase. Without seeing this letter, I don't know what purpose. All I know is that you were responsible to tell this board about the union, about the raise, and tell us what reason. They didn't specify a reason.
They don't have to. They do not have to tell us why they want more money in their dues, any more than an employee has to tell us why they want to pay more for life insurance. It's not in our wheelhouse.
It is, though. It says so.
Can I interrupt?
Yeah.
And for such a purpose.
The way I read the statute is to set up the original idea that they take any deductions, union dues, that we have the right to say, okay, yes, you can take union dues out, or we don't take union dues out. And every time we have a contract, we vote on that. Whether they take out $10, $50, $100, we don't care. And what they do with that money is none of our business. It's their money. We can't tell them off duty what they do in the unions. We have no say.
The only thing the statute covers is we have to give them permission to deduct the money. That's
it. You can't sign a contract in 2009 that gives them an allowance to have $12 union dues. In 2010, they said, want to raise it. We don't give them the ultimate authority to raise it any time they want within the contract.
We gave the administration, the administrative staff, the permission to deduct the money and distribute the money to the union. We have no say over whether they change that amount, which that all falls under that discretion, and we have no say over what they spend the money on. Maybe we don't like what they spend the money on, but we don't have any say over that because it's not part of what we do.
Everything you said after the first line was correct, but the first line was not correct. You said we gave the chief the authority to deduct the dues.
We did when we voted on the contract.
No. No,
every contract. I mean, it's in the labor contract.
We should let somebody else decide. And I think we have an attorney, and let him decide. The issue that comes to me is a civilian brings a complaint to the board and says there's something wrong. And I investigate it, and I find that, in my eyes, a dues increase only can come about when the union requested. By the way, they can't make an assessment. You can't say we're going to raise the dues. They've got to get permission from the members. They've got to get the permission from the members, come to you and say we want a dues increase, and then you have to come to us and we say yes or no.
Commissioner Murphy?
Regardless of the reason.
I have to agree with Commissioner Fitzgerald on this one. We need to turn this over to someone else to review and further on this meeting.
There we go.
Okay, Chief.
We'll do that. We'll move on.
Do you have something else? I just want to clarify this real quick.
Yeah.
I personally don't think we should spend attorney's fees for something that is pretty well cut and dried, but if that's what the board, if the consensus of the board decides that's what we should do,
so
then we should do that. But I'm in disagreement with spending, you know, probably $450 or $900 to have an attorney tell us what we already know.
Can we get a vote on this, please?
I don't know if we can vote on it because it's not an agenda item, but we can do a consensus of how we feel.
I don't think you can do a consensus. You can't take my word.
We can put it on next month. We can list it on next month's agenda and vote on it then. No, I'm not telling you. That's not what I'm doing. I'm just saying that we can't.
I have to be a little bit clear on this because I believe what I'm being asked to do is to say whether or not we can deny union dues deduction based on what it will be used for.
No. It's not a question at all.
Raising the price, raising the dues.
The question is, there was a dues increase.
Okay.
It came about only as a result of the union asking for it. They had to, now, in
yes,
effect,
sir.
They have to ask this board.
No, they don't.
For it. Yes, they do.
I think you should have the article in front of you. So it says the union will initially notify the district as to the amount of dues. Such notification will be certified to the district in writing over a signature of authorized officer of the union.
Exactly.
Changes in the union membership dues will be similarly certified to the district and shall be done at least 1 month in advance of the effect of such change.
They have to notify payroll that there's a different amount coming out of the check. That's the only requirement that they have. They can change it to whatever. The union membership has to vote on whether they agree to the dues increase, I believe. I don't even know that. I believe that's
yes,
the case.
Yeah.
I don't think somebody arbitrarily just raises the dues. And at that point, the only requirement that the union or any other employee has, if they're getting payroll deduction, is to let payroll department know that the amount that comes out of the checks within, they have to let them know, I believe it's 1 month in advance.
Yes,
and
sir.
That the amount's going to change so they can make the deduction. And that's it in a nutshell.
And attached is that letter that was sent.
Let me respond to that. Where do you get the background or the support to say what you just said?
Because I've gone to...
I'm reading you the code.
I go to every single FASD meeting. I'm certified, and I'm also... I sit on the legislative committee, and I'm very, very, very aware of statutes, and I've done this for a long time. So that's how I feel. If you feel that we need an attorney's opinion...
I'm reading the code. I'm not reading...
Let's put this on next month's agenda, and then we'll decide.
When I suggested a further review, we need to satisfy his question for further review. But I did not suggest an attorney review it. This can be in-house.
Okay. Let's put that on next month's agenda and move on because I think there's a conflict on interpretation of the statute, and we'll clarify that and we'll vote on this next month. Do you have anything else, Commissioner?
No, that's on Commissioner's business. That's all I have.
I have nothing. Next item is old business. Station 1 mural. Where do we stand on that?
Okay. Shifting gears. The Station 1 mural, that has been not at the forefront of our thought process here. However, it has been raised by Chairman Lohan, and I think
we made a commitment a few months ago
to
do this, and 9/11 came and went. I don't want another one to come and go without us doing something with it.
Well, okay, so here's what I'm looking for. We have the artist that we want to do the mural. Now the question is back to the brick. If we want to make this a permanent, here's why. Because is this a memorial or is it temporary? Because if it's going to be a long-term thing, I think we need to look at the brick situation. If we're going to be upkeeping the reason why is the last thing I was brought to was we weren't sure if the city was going to keep the mural up, in other words. But now that we're paying for it, it seems to me that it's going to be in perpetuity unless we decide that we're going to tear the building down.
We've had this discussion countless times about the brick. We can put it in a frame, from my point, and we need a consensus. We can put it in a frame, and then when it needs to be redone, it can be taken down. It can be taken wherever the artist wants to take it and have it redone and put back up, and the brick will remain brick. It will not.
Okay, so then we'll do, what we're planning on doing then is getting a billboard and having the artist paint the billboard in front of the brick, and it still will be attached to the brick.
I think billboard might be a loose term. We had talked about possibly having a frame that matches the brick that doesn't actually ruin the brick, because, you know, forever is a long time. And if we damage that brick and 15 years from now we decide that, or some other board or some other administration decides for whatever reason, or a building, maybe that piece gets built on, the city takes it away, something happens, and then we've ruined a wall on that building that's going to be there, that will be there for a long time. And I think that I'm talking to many people that have done this over the years. I don't know if we want to call it a billboard, but I do see we could put something up there that's movable or removable, and especially when it's going to, according to the city, every 3 years has to be redone. I'm sure that from the artist's concern, it would probably be easier to take it down, take it somewhere, fix it, and come back and put it back up. But that's how I feel about it. But I'd like to see whatever we do, whether the board decides that the brick, the paint on the brick is okay. We've made a commitment to the city, and I would like to see us. I'd like to see us move forward with it and have a nice park in place for the next 9/11 dedication. So.
I did want to say, if we're going to do the faux thing, then I'm going to have to look, and it may take some investigating, because the only thing that we've come up with so far has been like Ernie Signs, who could do a billboard, something similar to that. But from my understanding, that it will still have to be tap-conned into the brick.
That's fine. That's just a few holes.
Have we discussed this with the artist as to what he would suggest we use?
The artist wanted to paint on the brick.
No, but other than the brick, does he have an idea of what surface
not,
that he would like in a billboard, whatever it might
artist.
Be.
Mm. My understanding was that because we weren't concerned or sure that the city was going to keep it up was the reason, one of the main reasons why we didn't do it. But
I'd like to support painting the brick and assuring that the paint is properly applied and maintained, as we maintain everything in this fire department. I think we could paint it. It would be beautiful. We're not hurting the building. And I think it'll be more respected from people's view than a sign. So I think we should paint the brick, and that's my vote.
Because this is such a subject of this debate, I would either have to have a direction for a faux frontal of the brick and figure out what to use.
Well, you just said something about Ernie Signs. How did they get involved in this?
We haven't talked to anybody.
Oh, okay.
This was just a discussion we had amongst the staff, was throwing some ideas out there.
I mean, you could, in my mind, you could have what most artists paint on is a canvas, kind of weatherproof canvas that gets mounted to the brick, and the painting is on that canvas or whatever material. I don't know. I'm not an artist. I can't draw a straight line with a ruler. But I do know that if you mount something on a thin, whatever it is that's weatherproof, that somebody with a little bit of expertise that does this can probably figure this out, to attach it to the brick, and then as time goes on, if it has to be removed for whatever reason, or if we ever need to, whatever. I mean, whatever has to happen, it can, every 3 years can be taken down and fixed and put back up without putting a billboard on the side of the building.
Yeah, just address Mr. Fitzgerald. We've discussed this over and over again about the bricks. I was for the paint on the bricks, but through experts, we were told that it would not be a good thing to do with these bricks.
Yeah, I will make a suggestion. In a case like this, I would think the staff should investigate in every way you can and make a recommendation to us what to do, and I think then we should then follow your direction. We, none of us, have real any expertise in a subject like this to make a final decision.
Well, it's got to be,
I'm looking at aesthetics and beauty, and that's how I look at it. And I think it would be more beautiful painted on. But how are we going to resolve this, artist and no artist? I have respect for this staff, only to do the best thing they possibly could for this department, and I think that you should make a recommendation to us, as we often ask you in other things. So
let's get it
make
back
a
on
recommendation
the
chief and I will vote on it.
Let's just get it back on the front burner and see what we see where we go from here. Probably, I'm guessing if we're still going to use that same artist, I know there was an issue about the original mural that he gave us that none of us, not that we didn't like it, we just didn't think it was appropriate for what we were going to use it for. And far be it from any of us to tell an artist what he should think, but if it's going to be on our building, we should have some say over what it is. And I think that's the next step. Agreed?
Right.
We talk to the artist, and then the rest of this is just, we've talked about this ad nauseum, let's just get it going, and whether we paint it on the brick or don't paint it on the brick, he's still got to paint this thing, so let's get it started.
Okay, so just to clarify my direction, I will come back to the board with an artist rendition of a first responders or 911, 911 theme.
That was the Art League that brought him around,
yes,
correct?
Sir.
So I would think that the first step from here now would be, yes, to sir, get in touch with them and tell them what our concerns are. And if at that point it does, if we can't come to some type of an agreement, then we look for another artist and go a different direction. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've got time to do that, so.
And I think what he can do, we can come back with a painting that everyone,
sure,
can agree,
yes,
on, and then also have different mediums that
scenarios,
he may be able to use,
yeah,
the
exactly,
brick versus something,
yeah,
else, and
right,
maybe supply two different models,
perfect,
one with brick and one without on the brick.
Next item on the agenda is the construction of Station 6 bids. Does anybody have anything that they want to talk about with that? You have any comment?
I just did want to mention that the bids came in. Mr. Sherman is here if anybody had any questions about the bid process. I believe you saw the bid tabulation.
There, several of them were very, very close.
Yes,
unusually,
sir,
close. Yeah.
And I did want to mention that Gordon McGahey was mentioned by all the builders that they did an excellent job of providing the information. That is the reason why the bids were so close. So thank you, Mr. Sherman. And I do believe it was EnviroStruck that did win the bid.
Need a motion?
A motion in what regard?
To accept the low bid for the construction.
And we can discuss it after the motion is seconded.
Why?
Let's get a motion in a second.
I'll make a motion to accept the lowest bid as long as the chief has reviewed it and is agreeable to that lowest bid.
I will second that.
Okay, now discussion.
Which one is the lowest bid? They're so close.
EnviroStruck.
EnviroStruck number 4 on your list.
Do we have any experience with that company?
No, we do not. However, Mr. Sherman has worked on extensive projects.
They're local right here in Bay Springs. They're really offshoot from the Angeles Diamond, and they do.
I'm very familiar with one
and
of the
I'm
people.
I'm also
on
aware
that staff.
That they use local subcontractors too.
I'm also, from what I've been told by one of their executives way back, who I've known for a long time when he was with other companies, is that EnviroStruck on government contracts. Now, I don't have any proof of this, but he said when they bid them, they do their best job for a number, and then if it's a public entity, they take a 5% deduction. Now, I don't know. I was told that by somebody that is high up in that company, and they've done some work, from what I understand, with Astero, and they've done that before. So I don't know, but they came in. They did come in with the best price, which by I think we have to accept that, assuming that Gora has approved them, which I'm sure they have, or they wouldn't have been part of the bid process. If they're comfortable with them and they're the lowest bid, then I think that's probably the way we go, right?
Did the company that built Station 5, did they bid on this job?
That was through Mr. No, they did not.
Why not?
They were invited. They came to the pre-bid, but they chose not to submit a bid. I suppose they saw there was 20-some-odd GCs in here for the mandatory pre-bid, and they probably thought, who knows? Yeah.
I don't want to bid on the lowest bidder with that type of information. That all we
have.
Yeah,
I think we're required to. No?
I would hope that, again, the staff, you, my friend, would be able to get us some additional information. You have an expert here, and have you made a recommendation?
Yes, he has. You want to come up to the podium and maybe if I could inconvenience you?
No, I'm only saying, Chief, just to bid the lowest bidder is, I don't think it, I would want to.
We've reviewed these, sir, and these are good bids, and they're excellent bids.
Yeah.
And I would recommend we go with Envirostruct.
Well, the only thing I can say is I think you're bound by situation. Your attorney drafted the invitation to bid, the bid form, all of the front-end documents, which everybody adhered to here. And I think you would, if you went from the low bid, you probably would be looking for trouble.
Yes.
I'm going to follow your instructions and your recommendation. And if we vote, I'm going to vote for the lowest bidder in this case. First, I have no, this discussion's not finished. I have no one speaking up for someone else. And if someone was speaking up for someone else, I would give that some consideration. But right now, based on your remarks and your remarks, I have no choice but to bid on the lowest bidder.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No discussion. Okay.
We just had our discussion. Okay. Next thing is the job description updates.
Yes, sir. This was just an update, essentially, of all the job descriptions in the district. HR coordinator Hornberger and myself and the staff went over each job and made sure it was in line with what they actually do and what myself as the chief and the staff need the rest of the staff and firefighters to do as far as job functions and qualifications. They're basically the same as they were, with a few minor upgrades to mirror the contract with Local 3440.
Need a motion to accept the job description updates?
I'll make that motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Discussion.
Discussion.
Chief, would you do me a favor, please?
Yes,
give me a count on all these positions. How many battalion chiefs do we have? I don't have the number. How many fire inspectors? How many non-fire control inspectors? How many firefighters?
We have all that readily. We have all that readily available.
Yes, I don't want it now. It's just I do need it. I'm very often asked that question, and I don't know the answer. Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Next up, Chief Daigle's report.
Yes, sir. I have a few items. I did want to mention that Pam Hancock from PGIT has given the district a $5,000 check. It's a matching grant for money that we have spent on bunker gear. Basically, they allot us a matching grant for anything we do that promotes safety in the fire district. They do that every year if we comply, and we have. So we got a $5,000 grant, which essentially buys approximately two sets of gear for new firefighters. The Fitch report, the status on the Fitch report is they have done a GIS study. They've also done a analysis of our operations, meaning our response times, calls, station locations, and those things of that nature. They were here on the 30th and the 31st to do an extensive on-site review of our operations and visit all the facilities in the areas. I did speak with, I emailed Dr. Knight and told him your request, Commissioner Fitzgerald. He has not responded back to me yet. But there will be another site visit, unsure. In that same email, I requested he give us some dates that are potential for his next visit. And then he will be also, within this time frame, putting together the final report and also reviewing the staff, meaning reviewing our workforce equivalencies and things of that nature. And okay, update on Station 27. I think we've already addressed that. The only thing, it's been up and running. We have run 27 calls in a month with that station being open, which is actually ahead of what we initially thought. Deputy Chief Scott gave you the update on the boat. So any questions on that, those two items?
Are we running, we're running the boat, we got the boat in the water?
No, sir.
Why not? Hadn't we talked about that? I don't know,
I think we discussed it at one of the board meetings, maybe not. We contemplated that, and when we looked at power requirements for the boat, security, lighting, with no power yet out there because we don't have the permit,
So we're still trailering it from
We are.
Two?
We are.
Out to Carl Johnson?
Yes. Yes. And anticipating this being in a couple weeks and with some of the problems that we, you know.
Let me ask you this. Is there any reason why we can't drop in at station? At the station, there's a boat ramp there, isn't there?
There's not. There used to be, but it's been
get away with it.
Decommissioned, so to speak. They built a seawall across the back of it, so there is no working ramp.
Oh, okay. I thought that ramp was still
There's a small ramp now that
right.
the city owns across the way under the bridge.
No, I understand that, but right on the property where we are,
yeah,
that ramp
not,
is not
in it's not functional anymore.
Okay. Okay.
Our boat's actually out of commission right now. We pulled it to do some repairs, so because of the timing, we decided to get everything all ready. Hopefully,
okay.
in the next few weeks, we get started on the construction.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next item is legislation. I'm sure the board knows that there was a local delegation meeting on January 19th in which the consolidation issue was brought up. The local delegation denied moving forward at this time with a consolidation effort and looked more towards presenting on the next general election, which is 2018, a straw poll to determine whether or not to move forward with a referendum concerning consolidation. So that's essentially a two-year reprieve until it goes to a ballot. At this time, as we all know, things can change in Tallahassee. So we're keeping a close eye on it, and I will send you all the information that I do receive regarding the issue from Tallahassee. Annual report. Did the board get a chance to review the annual report?
Excellent job.
As always.
We will
Excellent
be sending
job.
That out public upon vote for the board that it would suffice. Would you all agree to allow me to send that out publicly?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Station 25, the ambulance. We did achieve contact with the high-ranking official for Lee County, and they state that there will not be an ambulance at that station until the end of this busy season.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to laugh, but as many calls as we're running, they're gonna wait till summer to put one there?
Yes, sir.
And is there any justification for that, considering it was in the budget for October 1st, the beginning of this fiscal year?
It's the only information we received from the county officials, was that they
and
were not going to.
They've already done work inside that station there, correct?
It was budgeted for October for this fiscal
right,
year.
But they've already actually.
I believe they have done some work in there.
Yeah.
And they've done that work and spent the money and to appease us to put another ambulance, and now they're going to wait till the end of busy season. Is there anything that we as commissioners can do to move that along?
No.
As you know, sir,
that's a situation where we have no control over the ambulance service in Bonita Springs.
Yeah, it that decision is mind-boggling. There has to be a reason. Obviously, they're not telling us what it is, but I just can't imagine that they're going to wait until season is over and then put an ambulance there. I've said enough. Thank you.
I figured I'd end on that high note. Thank you.
Thank you. Deputy Chief Scott?
I have nothing further.
Okay. And we've read Deputy Chief Madden's report. You have anything you'd like to add?
No, sir.
Nice job on the report.
Thank you, sir.
Any public comment? Anybody want to make a motion to call it a day?
I'll move. We close the meeting.
Okay.
Second.
Meeting adjourned. Thanks for coming.